So let me start first with inductors. And here's actually where we're going to spend most of our time, because planar inductors, and specifically on-chip planar inductors, are the hardest one to get right. And they are basically very non-ideal components. Honestly, even understanding them is pretty hard, as we'll see in a minute. But the basic geometry of a non-chip inductor is actually shown here. So you mostly have windings, planar windings, on a substrate. And you can see a picture, a schematic here. You can see an actual picture of an inductor right here. So it's primarily a two-dimensional device, as opposed to a natural three-dimensional device that most of you may be thinking about as an inductor. And that brings essentially the first hit. You're severely, again, limiting the volume where E and H could be stored. In this case, it's H. Additional difficulties, RFIC technologies typically have relatively thin metal. That's critical, particularly for low frequencies, where, as we will see, you need 5, 6, 7 micrometer thick inductor if you really want high Q, and many RFIC technologies don't provide that. Additionally, you have very high capacitive coupling between turns. That means the metals are too close to one another, so the capacitive coupling actually is very high between turns, and that makes the parasitics of the inductor very hard to deal with. And on top of all of that, you have high eddy currents in CMOS, because as the current is actually flowing on this inductor, you're exciting actually eddy currents inside the substrate, which further increase the resistance of this device. So planar inductors are really hard to do, and there is a very large literature, there's a very large body of literature that actually discusses how to do that, anywhere from modeling, anywhere from design techniques, and so on and so forth. So here we're only going to see the basics, but it is important to understand where non-ideal components, actually I say attributes, come from. Now, when you try to understand a model of an inductor, there isn't such a thing as a single model fits every inductor out there. But I did pick one model that you will see here that I would say fits most physically meaningful inductors. Let's put it that way. So there is some type of an inductance that is essentially the main inductance you're trying to get. Here we're calling that LS. There is some type of a resistance, RS. This mostly represents the resistance in the metal of the inductor. There's some type of parasitic capacitance, CS, that tries to capture the capacitance between the windings, the turns of the inductor. And then there are additional parasitic capacitances that are essentially going through the substrate. Now, how do we calculate all of these things is an interesting question. You know, nowadays we have very, very strong numerical electromagnetic tools that can actually do a really good job of estimating those. So typically, we get LS and RS mostly from low-frequency simulations. These are mostly depending on low-frequency simulations, as I said. And then we assume, for example, that the RS will change as a square root of the frequency due to the skin depth as the frequency is increasing. Then most of the parasitic capacitances will actually be captured from the high-frequency simulations close to the self-resonance of the inductor, which we will discuss pretty shortly. Now, how do you measure that? If you don't have the ability to simulate very accurately, the other way is to actually measure it. So normally, we'll take our inductance, we're actually going to short it at one end, and we're going to look at the measurement with a single end inductor, which basically means that the equivalent circuit will look something like this. Again, it's very difficult to match every single conceivable inductor to this model. And in fact, by the way I describe this model, you can understand this is a relatively narrow band model, meaning different things are computed at different frequencies. If you try to get a very wide band model, you usually have to add more components to what you see here. But nevertheless, let's see how this model behaves. So if I look at the reactance of this device, this is the X as a function of frequency, then I can see some interesting effects here. So the first thing that you will observe is that as you start increasing your frequency, the reactance will start increasing linearly with frequency, as it should be.